In this lecture, we are first going to look at several miscellaneous facilities that are provided by C++ but not fully discussed so far. You might like to use some of these during your projects. So as I said, we are going to discuss some useful features of C++ which will be necessary mostly during your project phase, and therefore we need to complete the discussion on those items. More importantly, we start discussion on the object-oriented programming paradigm, an extremely powerful mechanism of programming where we take our current notion of modularizing our programs through functions, structure definitions, etc., etc., to its full-blown logical conclusion where separation of entities and their behavior is taken to a level where the programming language itself supports such separation, and we will see how exactly we can define and use object classes, instantiate objects, and work on those objects with absolute guarantee that nothing else in our program will be affected whenever we operate upon these objects. We are specifically going to look at graphics objects because many of your projects will involve use of some kind of graphics or something. We will be using a open source rudimentary graphics library called EZ Windows. It has all been installed already on all your OSL machines. In the next week, you'll be working with these EZ Windows. We'll have more examples in the next lecture when we continue our discussion on object-oriented program. First, there's something that we had very briefly seen, but I'm elaborating it. When we define variables, we know that we can initialize variables at the time of their definition. In exactly the same fashion, arrays can also be initialized. The array initialization is done in a peculiar syntax. So for example, if you have a evaluated marks array of 5 elements, you can initialize all 5 elements by putting 5 values separated by commas in a curly bracket pair. So start a curly bracket pair, 5, 5, 20, 35, 35. Please note that this is not an assignment statement. It can only be done when you define the array. So it is one time initializing. Similarly, if you want to initialize, let's say, a character array with different characters, you can do so by writing, let's say, a char vowels 5 as an array and define these 5 elements. You can define an array without defining the size, in which case the compiler automatically takes the number of values which are given as initial set of values to be the size of the array. Alternately, you can have a large size. So you can, for example, have this is a perfectly valid statement. It does declare array to be of size 20. However, it initializes only 3 elements to given values. Based on the compiler implementation, the remaining elements may either be initialized to 0 or left untouched. There is one error in this declaration and initialization. Can you point that out? There is no syntax error, but there is a semantics error. Remember that character arrays are typically used to store strings. And how do we store strings in a character array? We put all the characters of the string and at the end put a backslash 0 as a null terminator, because every valid string is required to have a null terminator. It is important whenever you use string functions like string compare, concatenate strings, etc. Do you think that char vowels 5 is a correct declaration? What will be the impact of this declaration? This has 5 elements, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. The initialization says put these 5 values in the 5 elements. Is there any space for backslash 0? No. So while this initialization is correct, please understand that it is not obligatory that every character array be used only as a valid string. It is required to be a valid string if you treat that particular array as a valid string in either function calls or anything else. But you can, of course, stuff any 5 values of 5 ASCII values in that. But generally, since a character array has a connotation of being a character string, which is null terminated, it is only proper that you put the array size to be one larger than the actual number of elements that you wish to, in case you want to treat this as an array. So you might want to make this as 6, for example, and put an additional backslash 0 as an additional 6th character in the initialization. As a very special case, since character arrays invariably are used to store null terminated strings, the following initialization is valid and permitted. This initialization is that if you declare some char array, say line 80, you can say, hello world, how are you, semicolon. This is initialization during definition. I again repeat, you cannot use it as an assignment statement anywhere else in the C program. Only when you define the array, you can give the initial value. In case you assign a double quoted character string as an initial value to the array, the backslash 0 is automatically inserted, because C++ understands that you are trying to put a valid string there. Obviously, the size of the array should be one larger than the number of characters that you put. Of course, if you put in less number of characters, it will be null terminated at the appropriate point. Next, we revisit the way we define our structures and functions. Ordinarily, structures, functions would be defined as a part of our main program only. But in the last few occasions, we had seen that we could define the struct definition outside the main program, before the main program. We could define the function prototypes outside the main program, or even full function definitions. This is one example where I have defined a struct empinfo, which has two parts, integer employee ID and float salary. Then I have defined, just like I had a print student info kind of function last time, I have print emp data function, which has structure info type emp as the parameter, and for this emp.empid and emp.salary is printed out by this function. So it's merely a function. Whenever somebody calls it, it will print those two values. As I said, ordinarily I could write these just before the int main. I could write these even inside int main. That is perfectly fine. Okay. As long as I write these before defining anything. The function definitions usually precede int main. If I want to code the function definition at the end of int main, then I will have to give at least the function prototype here. That is the standard practice. So there is nothing new in this. Once we define it like it, we can use the struct info type to define a new variable, say E, assign values to E, and print that value, whatever. The issue is that suppose we are doing a group project and I want to use this struct info, but I am not the partner who has defined this struct info and this function. This has been defined by someone else, some other member of my team. Now that member of my team will define it in a separate file. How do I say that I want that file to be included when my program is compiled? Otherwise, my program will not compile properly. I therefore look for a facility by which I could define these things somewhere else. So suppose my friend has created a file called emp.h. I do not want to retype the entire definition and everything. First of all, I may make a mistake. Secondly, why should I do that donkey work? Somebody else has done it already in my team. Suppose I ensure that this emp.h, I copy as it is. He mails it to me and I put it in my working directory. Can I tell the compiler that, look, Baba, when you compile my main program, please include that emp.h file also before you start compile? If I can say that, it will save a lot of things. Then a group could depute one of the members to maintain the repository of several such .h files for whatever function definition, structure definitions are required. And anybody who is writing a program which requires those definitions can simply tell the compiler that before compiling my program, take this header file. It is called a header file. That is what .h signifies. So suppose I created such a header file. There is indeed a facility available in all compiler systems, certainly in GCC, whereby we can direct the compiler to include this file in our program. The way this is done is very simple, and you would have guessed it because you have already seen some include statements appearing in your programs, albeit of a different nature. So just as I say include IOStream, include CSTDlib, I can say include double quote emp.h. The moment I say this, the file, of course, emp.h is expected to be in your current directory. If it is not, if it is suppose in your friend's directory, then it is possible for you to give an absolute path of that file also in the string. Because after all, what this string contains is nothing but the file name. And file name can include the relative path where the file belongs. Needless to add, once I do that, this file will be included. How it will be included? It will be included by a stage in the compilation called pre-processing. In the pre-processing stage, the compiler does not immediately start translating your program into machine code. It actually looks at the entire text, and if there is any missing text, such as the one in emp.h, which is somewhere else, it will actually copy that emp.h physically into your program. It is like you using a gedit window, okay, and copy pasting that emp.h and then saving it and then asking it to be compiled. It is almost like that. So physically, compiler will do that job for you automatically. This is done by using compiler directives. Hash include is one such directive. When you say hash include, the corresponding file is included. So whenever the compiler actually starts compiling your program, it sees the entire text, including whatever was written in emp.h. And that is how things are perfectly fine. There is still another alternate way. Suppose in my team project, that friend of mine who has written this emp.h, he not only writes the emp.h, student.h, something else.h, giving the definition of the structures, but he does something smarter. He has written, let's say, 20 functions which operate upon these structures, like print employee info, print student info, update student's mark. What he is worried about is that if people have access to the source code of those functions, somebody may be tempted to make some small change in the function. Now, if five members of the team make five small changes in the functions, ultimately there will be no single definition available. Therefore, he says, I will give you the structure definitions because that you need in order to understand what is the prototype definition of function, what are the structures, etc. But as far as the actual function code is concerned, I will not expose that to you. Instead, I will compile all those functions and keep them separately. Is that feasible? We are not talking now of a preprocessor directive which can get the entire source code from emp.h or such files and include it for compilation. He is going one step forward. He says, you write your program, you compile your program, but after you compile, somehow make sure that your compiled program and my compiled functions are linked together so that when you get a a.out file, it is a total file containing compiled versions of everything. That way you will save some time because you don't have to recompile the functions which have been compiled. After all, the same functions are going to be used by all five members of the team. So if functions are written by someone else and have been already compiled and are kept elsewhere, they are kept as a library. The example that I gave you is a small scenario where a group of 5, 6, 7 people are working on a project. In larger life, such functions are written constantly by many people in the world. As a matter of fact, there is no programming language which permits you to write effective programs well without a group of people having written a large number of functions and kept them compiled somewhere. Imagine our own plight. Suppose you want to do some mathematical computations. You have to calculate sine theta, cos theta, tan theta. You remember a library called CMath? When you say include CMath, somebody who has written these functions, sine, cos, log, etc., etc., they are all suddenly available to you. Is the source code getting included? No. What that somebody has done is that somebody has compiled all these functions, kept them somewhere as in the form of a library of functions. So somewhere you should be able to tell the compiler that as far as header files are concerned, include them in my program. As far as these compiled versions are concerned, first compile my program, and the compiled version you link it to that particular function. So this is what we need to do whenever there are functions which are pre-compiled and kept somewhere else in a library. Even if the functions are kept in the library, please understand that the prototype definitions of those functions must be included during my compilation. Otherwise, compiler will not understand. When I say sine of x, if compiler has no clue what function sine is, what parameters it requires, floating point, fixed point, etc., etc., it won't be able to compile. So even though people have compiled these functions and kept them in separate library, in the library also there are two separate components which are to be maintained. One component is a text header file, which may have definition of type, structures, etc. And it will also have prototype definition of all functions which are later on available as a separate compiled file. So when you say include cstlib, for example, or include cmath, two things happen. During the pre-processing phase, from that library, the equivalent text header files are picked up and brought and put together in your text file so that when you compile, compiler knows what. And finally, at the end of compilation, those pre-translated functions are linked into your program. It is therefore important for us to understand the compilation process in a slightly detailed fashion. So what do? Ordinarily, we use a command C++ myproc.cpp. All of you are familiar. What happens? It creates an executable file, a.out. And then you say /a.out, your program gets executed. It appears to you as if it's a one-step process. C++ myproc.cpp, flash comes out a.out. That does not work like that in real time. In real practice, the compilation process is a multi-stage process. In the first stage, the program first includes all the header files, etc., etc. That is called the pre-processing stage. It is not written here because we just discussed it. So there is a pre-processing stage in which all the compiler directives are expanded, are executed to make actually a text file of your .cpp, which includes all the header files, etc. That is the pre-processing stage. After the pre-processing stage, your program is compiled. And this compiled version becomes what is known as an object code. Typically, if I have a program called myproc.cpp, the corresponding object code will be kept in a file called myproc.o. This object code is, you can say, semi-translated version of your program. Why semi-translated? It is still in the final machine language form, but it is not ready to execute. It is not ready to execute. It is semi-cooked form. Something else has to be done. And what is that something else? That something else is assembling that code and linking it to other pre-compiled programs which are included from the library. As a matter of fact, not a single C++ program can run without linking something or the other from the standard library. Remember, include IO stream. That's the basic that you need to include in anything. In general, in real life, you'll be including a whole lot of libraries. Some standard libraries from C++ and some others which you yourselves have written. We shall later on see how to create such libraries on your own. You're already familiar how to create such external header files. Simple, gedit and say emp.h and write down all the headers and then include it. That is simple. But if I have written functions, how do I compile? In what form do I keep? How do I tell my compiler later when it is compiling my program to include this particular library? So the library must have some name like cmath, cstdlib. I may call it cmylib or whatever. Okay. Incidentally, it is not necessary that we always use only a.out as the output file produced by the final stage of the compilation. I can give it any name that I wish. Indeed, professional programmers never work on a.out for a simple reason that at any one time, you may be working with 5 or 6 different programs. You might want to keep all 5 or 6 compiled so that you run one, then immediately run another, then test third. remember that if you run one and try to run another, that another does not have any a dot out because it has been overwritten by the latest program that you have compiled. There can be only one a dot out in your file. So it would be nice if you compile your programs always to produce the equivalence of a dot out for every program that you compile. And the easiest thing to do that is to give this command, C++ myprog.cpp -o. -o stands for output. The final output that you create should not be a dot out, but should be, let's say, myprog. The extension is immaterial, by the way. A dot out is only a ease of way. Somebody standardized on a dot out. So it need not be myprog dot out. It is not necessary. Any name you can give. It is customary to give the same name as the name of the program. For the simple reason that all programs that you will write will have unique names. And therefore, if the same name is given, there is no confusion that is possible. So is this clear? How the compilation process works. The notion of libraries is very, very important. As I said, first of all, you get the more power in the programming language because of these libraries. Second, these libraries also isolate issues and keep them separate. While computing sine, you are not wondering how to calculate logarithm. While computing matrix inverse, you are not worried about something else. So you localize the problems and put all your code and data structures at one place related to whatever problem you are solving. The libraries which are pre-written and pre-compiled come in different forms. For most Unix systems, they take the form of one of the two forms. One is called the archive files. They're the traditional library files which have an extension .a. If you go in Ubuntu or any Unix system to a directory /lib or /user/lib, you'll find a lot of .a files there. The other type is called shared objects, which has an extension .so. These are less generic than .a, but that is immaterial as far as we are concerned. These would be files that would be used invariably in much of your programming work. The corresponding nomenclature used by the Microsoft environment is dynamically linked libraries. They are similar to shared object kind of. So they have an extension .dll. Those of you who have worked on Microsoft OS environment and in C, C++ or any programming language, you will find that the operating system environment consists of a large number of such dynamically linked library files, .dll files. Indeed, the operating system itself, whether it is Unix or Microsoft or HP UX or IBM AIX or whatever, the operating system itself is millions of lines of code, as I said. Nobody writes a single monolith million line program. So there are separate functions. A major function, handle file system. Another major function, handle memory allocation. Third major function, allocate processing resources to different executing programs. Within that, thousands of other functions. Much of these are also written in terms of files. So the operating system itself, when you install an operating system, which is an executable file actually, before that, you take the operating system source code, which itself could be written in any language, compile and link it with various libraries and install it. It is slightly problematic because it's a chicken and egg story. Without the operating system, how do you put a compiler and compile? Without a compiler, how do you do the operating system compilation? I'm not going into those details. Suffice it to say that libraries constitute 90% of the power of computation that you get when you express yourself in any programming language. So all standard libraries of C++ provide an interface. What is your interface? Your interface, for example, is to be able to say, when in your program you write such a statement, you are using an interface called SIN, in bracket parameters. A function called methodology is nothing but an interface. Somebody else has written that function and he is telling you how to use that function. So whether a function has one parameter or 20 parameters, how the function is invoked is all depends on how the function is written. This is how you get the power. So you write your own programs. In addition, you use programs written by others through a programmer's interface. libraries provide such programmer's interface. Such interfaces, by the way, whereby you can call other functions or call other things, are known as APIs. And the power of any environment, whether it is operating system, whether it is some libraries, whether it is this or that, is always judged by the power of the APIs that is available. Note that a library such as CMath could again contain hundreds of thousands of lines of code. If someone told you, read all those 100,000 lines of code and then figure out how to calculate sine, how to calculate cos, you'll go mad. Therefore, these application programmers interfaces are separated out. List of functions is given somewhere. How to call a function is given. What does that function return is given. And that is your interface. You need not know then how somebody is calculating sine or x or cos or whatever inside. So the beauty of API is they filter the knowledge of usage of certain pre-written programs, and they give you that filtered knowledge in terms of an interface that you can use, that your application software can use. This particular fact, this particular feature is carried to its logical end when we discuss the object-oriented paradigm, which has emerged as the most popular programming paradigm these days. We'll do that later. So is this clear? Fine. Some additional features, we often require debugging help. So whenever we write statements, we're not sure whether something is working or not. Say for example, I opened a file. So I have defined an in file, it's called data.txt, and I open it as a read file. Ordinarily, I expect the file to be open, but there could be various reasons. File may not exist in my directory. File may exist, but I may not have read permission in that file, to that file. Okay. File may be corrupted, whatever. If for some reason the file cannot be opened, the file pointer will not be assigned a valid value, it will have a null value. We have seen earlier in our programming examples that after opening a file, we will invariably look at that pointer, and if it is equal to null, we will say error, return. So we terminate a program. This is not the only situation. There could be other situations where I expect, let's say somewhere in my program, some value of x should be greater than y. And only then it should work. But suppose my program, while testing, it bombs. And I don't know what is happening. So what I will say, if x is not greater than y, get out. I want x to be greater than y. If that assertion is wrong, I want to get out. But while getting out, I want to print an error message where something has gone. I might create such 20, 30 debugging exits that something goes wrong, come out. However, once I get a hang, I find out, oh, I made a mistake in this logic here, that something there, etc., and correct the program, I would not like such arbitrary error handling messages to remain there in my program. But on the other hand, when I return once, I compile, they will always be compiled. I have two choices. A, physically remove all of those. Or B, comment all of those. But suppose I comment 20 such messages. Now, after some time, my friends decide some additional functionality should be given, I write that. And that additional functionality, while writing it, I make changes, the whole thing collapses again. And I want to again start debugging. So I'll have to hurriedly remove all those comments from all the 20 statements that I had written. That will amount to too much of unnecessary work. There are multiple facilities in programming languages which permit you to write such debugging code, but automatically tell the compiler that if I am satisfied with the status of my program, don't bother compiling these statements. But if I tell you I am not satisfied, please compile and execute. One of such features is called the assert library. The assert library is a macro. We shall study more about macros in the next class. It's a useful diagnostic tool. In order to use this library, you have to include a special library called CAssert. So in your include statement, if you say CAssert, the assert provides the same functionality in a compact form. I can, for example, write assert in file equal to F open something, not equal to none. Assert means I am stating an assertion. Assertion is I believe this is true. What do I believe to be true? I believe that whenever I open this file, it will be properly opened. And therefore, it will not be a null pointer. So my assertion is this pointer is not null. There are two possibilities. One, the assertion is true, in which case I want to continue. Second, the assertion is false. That means the file was not open. In which case I want to do what I did earlier, print an error message and get out. That is exactly what the assert statement does. So if this assertion turns out to be false, an error message is given. It is not set out onto your std out, but it is put on std err. You will remember we discussed the OS environment and we said every time your program is executed, it gets three files attached to it. One std in for keyboard input and the other std out and std err, both of which go to terminal. So actually when you see an output coming on the terminal, you cannot figure out whether this is coming from std out or is it coming from std err. You will see both of that coming here. But in case an assert statement fails, you will come to std err. The advantage of std err is as follows. You remember we discussed file redirection. I can say execute this program greater than some file. So all output goes there. That greater than applies to std out. If I have an assert statement, my errors will still come, error messages will still come on my screen. They will not go to that file. Pure output will go to that. So I can sort of separate out these two. There is one problem with this statement. Okay, first let us discuss. Suppose I have such 20 assertions in my program, not necessarily related to file. As I said, I want to assert that X should be greater than Y at this point. If it is not, I want to terminate the program. Somewhere else, I want to do some other complicated test, any condition. You say, I assert that this condition is true. The assert statement will check that condition at that point in time. And if it is false, it will give an std err message. That message is, by the way, quite comprehensive. For example, in this case, suppose this is a statement in line number 12 in your main program. The output will read something like this. In a dot out, int main, line 10, colon, assertion failed, and then it will write the entire condition that you have written. You can very easily see where a problem has occurred. In a 500 line program, you can very easily see. Now, as I was saying, suppose you have cleaned up your program, no mess there, everything is working fine. Now you don't want these assert fellows to be implicated because you have taken care of error handling in some special fashion. That is the purpose of writing good professional program. You don't want errors only to go in a professional program, errors to go to std error. After all, the end user is playing a game of snakes and ladders, for example. Now, you suddenly don't want to say, assert snake not found or some such thing during the game. It has to work properly and that error has to come separately. And that you would like to give a proper error message even in case the program bomb, which says that, sorry, my dear friend, your original definition of snakes and ladders is not proper because there is a snake where a ladder ends and there is a ladder where that snake ends. So I have detected a loop. You'll keep moving around perpetually in that board, nowhere going up and down. So when I detect such error, initially during debugging, I could have used that assert statement. But later, because I'm getting into an infinite loop sometimes, why? But later on, I would have handled that thing situation separately. I would like to suppress this error. To suppress all asserts in your program, there is a simple mechanism. You can include another macro definition by using a word hash define ndebug. Ndebug means no debugging. Remember, I told you an error in a program is a bug. Removing that bug is called debug. So when I say no debug, then even though assert statements are there, they will not be compiled by my compiler because I have said no debug. Of course, I must state that before the inclusion of C assert. There are many other facilities. There are actual debuggers. One debugger we will discuss in the next lecture, whereby you can actually execute your program step by step. And at every step, you can see what is the value of this variable, what is the value of this pointer, what is the value of this structure element, whatever. Here is another compiler directive for macro definitions. Consider this. Hash define max size 2000. Here, I am not declaring a variable and I am not initializing a variable. Far from it. Instead, I am declaring what you may call a symbol, which is M-A-X-S-I-Z-E. And I am declaring a token which is supposed to be the value of that symbol, which is 2000. This is a pre-processing definition. This definition is handled at the pre-processing level. What the compiler does is that it works as if you have opened a gedit window, and in that gedit you have said find and replace. Max size, find max size, replace by 2000. Physically, wherever max size appears in your program, it will be replaced by 2000. It might appear, for example, in your program where you have said emp id max size. Remember what I had said time and again? You cannot declare an array with a size which is not pre-known. Therefore, you cannot say emp id, say size, where size is itself read as an input. Because that input will not be available unless the program is executed. So that is wrong. Why it is right here? It is right here because before compilation itself, MAXSIZE would have been replaced by 2000. Because that is what this definition says. Why is this important? I could have written it 2000 itself. This is important for the following reason. I might, later on in my program, I might have an iteration which says something like for I equal to 0, I less than max size plus plus. And somewhere else, I might simply say C out. So you see, the size of an array is an important component which may be used at 10 different places in my program. Now imagine that for some reason you decided that your array should be 200. Size should be 200. Then what would you do? You would declare your array to always say int emp id 200. For I equal to 0 to 200, less than 200. You won't of course print because 200 is known. But basically the number 200 will occur at 10 different places in your program. Now when you sit together and discuss the project further, somebody points out, boss, this size 200 is not sufficient. The solution that I want to seek of this complicated matrix equation may have an order greater than 200. Maybe 500 is the right place. Then what I will have to do? I will have to change wherever I have said 200, I will have to change it to 500. I might forget to change at one place, causing a lot of problems. If I have used a macro like this, hash defined max size 200, let's say initially, it would, when I compile it, it will compile with size 200, it will print 200, it will run this loop for 200. But the moment this decision is made, I will simply say define max size 2000 and recompile the program. What the compiler will do is, it will replace max size by 2000. Okay. Suppose I use this to say hash define C 28. Wherever C appears, C will be replaced by 28. You have to be very careful with what symbol you define and what you replace it with. The defined symbol should be uniquely identifiable. Otherwise, something very funny could happen. There was I don't know whether I shared this with you or not. In the SQL programming language, somebody wrote a program to find out whether the customers had in their description of where they are, let us say, members of something, whether they are members of any public limited company. So somebody searched for a string called public. Okay. What he wanted to check was whether members have LIC policy. So he actually gave a string called LIC. PUBLIC also contains LIC. So in this search, everything that was public also came out with people not having any LIC policy. So the the marketing people who were given those customer IDs, saying this fellow has a LIC policy, go and call him. They started calling everybody and people started rapping them. I have nothing to do with LIC. Now this kind of thing should not happen in your program. So you better be careful about what symbols you define and what you replace. That's the reason why macros usually have typical thumb rule, define a macro symbol to be all caps, because it is unlikely that you will use all of them as caps in normal variables and other. We look at another important function which is extremely useful whenever you are doing simulation of games of chance. You want to generate random numbers. There is a random number generator function called RAND. This generates successive calls to this function will generate a sequence of numbers which are apparently unrelated to each other, and therefore they are called random numbers. Of course, this sequence is generated by some algorithm, and that algorithm will generate a number based on some previous number and some steps in the algorithm. So obviously, if you give a starting point, that algorithm will always generate the same sequence. The trick is whether I can cause a different starting point to be given to that sequence. We shall see that in a moment, but this function is used in this fashion. When I say num equal to RAND bracket, no parameter is required. Every call to RAND is guaranteed to give a new number in the sequence. It will never return the same number. It will return the next random. So if I want to generate, let's say, 9 random numbers, I can generate 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 and print them. I will get separate random numbers generated. You are all familiar with these? Anybody who has played snakes and ladders or Ludo or something will know. Games of chance, you just throw a dice. A dice has 6 faces and each face has a unique number. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now when you want to simulate a board game, then you would like to simulate the throw of a dice. The point in throwing a dice is every time you throw, randomly some number will come up. Okay. How do you simulate such randomly generated numbers? Well, you can use RAND. For example, if I generate a random number, I know the number generated is an integer number between 0 and some arbitrary max number called rand max. If I take a modulo 6, I will get a number between 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And if I add 1 to it, I got a dice value. So I can generate a large number of such dice values. I can, for example, simulate a game of snakes and ladders where the computer plays player 1, computer also plays player 2. So I start it and I may have some graphical display of how my coins are moving on that board. Every time a number is generated, it is displayed. Player 1 generated 4, player 2 generated 6, played again, generated 1. Somewhere you got into snake, onto ladder, whatever, whatever. The point is, I run this program, it runs perfectly well. Tomorrow when I run it, will I get the same sequence? Unfortunately, yes. That is because the starting point, when you first call the random number, it will have some fixed algorithm to give that, and that sequence will be generated. So if in your game, for the first time, player 1 wins and player 2 loses, for eternity, player 1 will win. Now, that is not simulation. You would like different sequences of random numbers to be generated. That is one. The second issue is, are these random numbers really good? How do you define a good random number? A good random number in a throw of dice, for example, is an equiprobable random number. That is, one is likely to come as many times as 2, as many times as 3, etc. So suppose you throw a dice, say 60 times. On an average, you expect 1 to come 10 times, 2 to come 10 times, 3 to come 10 times, give or take one or two. I would like to check the property of this random number generator, whether it generates uniformly distributed random numbers or not. And second and most important, somehow I would like to ensure that because of a certain way in which the first sequence comes, my player 1 does not always win every time I run the program. There is a good probability chance that any player can win. We shall see how both of these things are tackled. First of all, as I told you, there is an internal algorithm which generates a random number, and that algorithm depends upon some starting point. at any time of the point when you call this for the first time, there is a fixed starting point that algorithm has, which it uses every time. Subsequent calls will, of course, the algorithm internally will remember in its own data structure what was the last value given, and it will give you a next value. If you could break this jinx by giving an initial seed value yourself, saying, I don't like to start every time from that point, I'll give a different value. After all, there are large number of possible values that you can start with. So collect a value from me. I'll say give seed value for random sequence. I collect the seed. How do I inform the random number generator that I want you to use this as the seed value? There is another function called srand, which is like saying set the seed for this random number generator. So when I call srand, I have to give a parameter, which is a number. And this is the number which will be used for random number. Subsequently, when I generate dice values, I will get a sequence which will be initiated by this seed. Every time I run a program, I give a different seed, it will generate a different seed. Anytime I run a program giving the same seed, I am guaranteed to generate the same sequence that was generated last time. Only one hitch here. Every time I now play a game of snakes and ladders or game of Ludo or any such chance game, distribution of playing cards, whatever, which I want to do randomly, I have a problem. Every time it asks me, give me a seed value. In a professional program, I write such game of snakes and ladders, something, give it to you, you play. Now, he is expecting snakes and ladders, suddenly say, give a seed. He'll say, who is seed? Because the end user is executing. I would like automatically a new seed value to be given, which is guaranteed to be different. How can I guarantee? Should I generate a random number and use it as a seed? Yes? Seems to be a sensible option. Will it work? It will not work. Because every time I run the program, the first random number generated will be same. And therefore, it will change the original seed, but it will change it with the same value every time. So randomly generating the seed guarantees non-random numbers generated every time you run it. I need to give a seed which is dependent on something which changes. Guaranteed fashion, it changes every time you execute a program. There is only one commodity in the whole universe which changes in a guaranteed fashion, and that is time. Time always goes ahead. Even if I run the program now and immediately run it in 2 seconds, 2 seconds have elapsed. Nobody can stop that. How nice it would be if I could somehow get the time of the day today and say, use this time. Of course, every day the time recycles from 0 to 24 hours. Suppose I say time of the year. Again, the year will recycle. Next year, again, somebody will get this. There is a mechanism. Every computer system maintains what is known as a real-time clock inside the computer hardware. That real-time clock is usually set to current date and time. From that real-time clock, which is managed by the operating system, any programming language can make a function call through an API called a system call and say, give me the current time. If I could get the current time, then I would be able to use that as a seed value, provided I appropriately convert it into integer if it is not an integer. Apparently, such a facility exists. The value of time is available in another set of libraries called ctime. So if I include ctime, then there is a function called time. Time can be invoked with different parameters to give different things. Fundamentally, if time is invoked with a parameter value 0, then it returns a large integer, which is the number of seconds that have passed or elapsed since midnight of 1/1/1970, Greenwich Mean Time. Somebody decided Greenwich Mean Time, 1/1/1970 is the base date. Now from then, seconds are passing. Large number of seconds have already elapsed. As we speak, more seconds pass. Anytime you make a call at time 0, it will return an integer saying, at this juncture, so many seconds have passed since 1/1/1970. You agree that this number will be different anytime you execute the program? Except in one peculiar case. The real time of your computer has got stuck. It is not running. So every time the operating system cannot tell you time by looking at a watch. It will make a call to this real-time clock. Suppose the battery has gone kaput. You might have seen, some of you might have noticed that when battery of the real-time goes kaput, when you boot your system, you will typically get today's data as 11-1980 or some such thing. What it will mean is time zero will always return a fixed number of seconds. But in more self-respecting computers where batteries are working properly, you will get a normal real time. In all your machines in the lab, you will get a normal real time. If you therefore say SRAND time zero, this time zero will go to the clock and get time in seconds from this point, and that will become the seed value, guaranteeing every time you will generate a different sequence of random. Is that clear? In the process, you also learn the call for time for various purposes. You can use it in your program even other way. It is not uncommon, for example, for people who write very large computational programs to find out how long a particular portion of their algorithm is taking. Let's say you are inverting 500 by 500 matrix. So somewhere before you begin that inversion process, you can say time something and print that time or store that value somewhere. Execute that part of the algorithm, again call time. And then the difference between the two will tell you so many seconds were required to do this computing. As a matter of fact, you remember we had seen a operating system command where we say dot slash a dot out. Instead, if we say time dot slash a dot out, it will print three different times, execution time. Where do those times come? Operating system also makes a call to this time and gets the value. Next is the second question. Do I get uniformly distributed random numbers? So here is a program. It sets count six elements. It wants to count how many times one occurs, how many times two occurs, how many times three occurs. It sets up a random number seed, generates a large number of random numbers, say 60,000 numbers. Every time it will generate a random number, it will take modulo 6 and add 1. That is the dice value. Since the arrays are 0 to 5, it will subtract 1 and use the dice value itself as an index. You remember associative array? So if 1 comes, the 0th element is incremented by 1. If 5 comes, 4th element is incremented. 6 comes, 5th element is incremented. So these six elements of array will be automatically incremented every time a number is generated. At the end, when all 60,000 numbers have been generated, you would expect each one of them to be roughly around 10,000. If that is so, then you have a uniformly distributed random number set. So you print out these counts. I have run this program for 60,000 and for 6 lakhs. And these are the counts that I got. Depending upon when you run this program, you may get a different count because remember, seed is set to time zero and therefore every time there will be a different sequence of random. So you look at it first time 9,885, 10,000, 10,135, 9,992, 9,999, 9,896. You will agree that roughly it is uniformly distributed. You run it for 6 lakh, you would expect every number to be 1 lakh times coming. It is 99,716, 1 lakh something, 99,000 something, 99,000 something, 1 lakh something. Again, this tells us that the C++ random number generator is reasonable. This also tells you that professionally, when somebody gives you, saying that I have a very good random number generator, you might want to run such tests quickly to ascertain whether the random numbers generated are truly uniformly distributed or not. Because these are not strictly random numbers, they are called pseudo-random numbers, since they are generated by an algorithm. Later on, some of you will work on stochastic models. Okay. Stochastic models are useful not only in engineering systems, but even in financial systems. Models which determine, you know, the flow of funds in large economies, stock market models, share price models, variety of things. Okay. So these stochastic models require you to use what is known as queuing theory, where certain events that occur, they arrive as per certain probability distribution. And mostly those probability distributions are not uniform probability distributions. Those could be, they are called Poisson arrival, exponential arrival. So basically different types of distribution. It is possible to map the arbitrary type of distribution function of random numbers onto a uniformly distributed number, generate uniformly distributed numbers, and convert them into a sequence which actually has a probability distribution something else. It's not the topic of the discussion here. I'm just telling you that such things are feasible, and that is why the random number generation becomes a very, very important point in any kind of task that you do random sampling. Yeah, sure. No. Please remember, time is used only once in my program. I'm never coming back to that point again. This is the SRAND time zero. That's the only time that the setting is done in that algorithm. By SRAND time zero, I don't mean every time you generate a random number, you use that time. No. SRAND is executed only once. And that is to set the starting point of that algorithm. Subsequently, you will call only RAND. And subsequently, all the calls will generate a random number based on the previous number that was generated, and so on, typically. So setting is done only once in lifetime, in the execution of your program. When you re-execute the program, then only it will be done. Not only. With this, we now move over to a preliminary discussion on object-oriented programming. We will, of course, be discussing this a lot more, but here we are just understanding some simple concepts. To tell you this logical isolation and logical construction of real-life objects, I have shown here an example of a cell. Those of you who have studied preliminary biology will know that every living organism has cells. All of us have cells which are different kinds of cells. Eyes have rod cells, cone cells, blood cells, etc. Cells, all cells have a peculiar property. They have an external membrane, and there is fluid inside this membrane. And inside this fluid, there is a nucleus. The entire behavior of the cell is determined by properties which are hidden inside that nucleus. The interaction between this cell and other cells happens only at the membrane level. There is no way any external entity or any other cell can find out what is there inside the nucleus. There is no direct access to that. The nucleus, therefore, is a private component of a cell. It contains its own information. How does the cell interact with the other cell? Well, when the cells interact across membranes, and the modeling that human beings have done on that is to say that a cell sends a message to another cell. For example, take human mechanism of sending a signal. Let's say I want to open my hand. The brain will pass a signal by which perhaps the cells are being instructed to expand. So all cells will follow that. The message is going from some mechanism through those membranes. But the actual expansion is happening because inside the cell, the nucleus has decided to do something such that the fluid expands or whatever. This is how nature has provided isolation as well as segregation of activities. Compare that with our programming paradigm. In our programs, originally we started by saying define variables arrays and then read some values, compute something, print something. When our programs became larger, we realized that, oh, I have defined this 38 variables, 22 arrays, and I am doing something with this here, something with that there, etc., etc. It is becoming clumsy for me. Then I realized that suppose I am handling, let's say, student data, it would make far more sense for me to define a student.h file or a student info data structure and then define members of that data structure such that when I operate, I am not operating upon arbitrary variables, but I am operating upon those components of a student, and I know I'm changing the student's marks or I'm changing the student's hostel room or something like that. So what I have done, I have achieved two things. A, I have sort of isolated student from rest of the information that is there in my program. B, I'm now very sure that whenever I say student.marks equal to 28.5, then those marks are not being assigned to somebody else. It is being assigned to a particular member student of a group. If I consider a student to be a cell and all students to be a class of cells, then I am trying to do exactly what I was doing here. Except there is one difference. My data structures might be separated out, student, employee, this, that, that. But my program structures, the behavior of the elements of these student structure, et cetera, are frittered all across my code. I can do anything anywhere. And I can do it any which way. Somebody can change that program to say, grade is equal to AA. Everybody will get an A grade. There is no safety in that mechanism. Whereas in a cell, I cannot know how to, let's say, make significant changes in the nucleus of the cell. The only mechanism I have is, I can pass this message and cell will react like this. Beyond that, I have no control. A similar paradigm in programming has been prepared, has been created, understanding that objects are independent entities, each of which has properties and behavior. And similar objects form a single class, such as a class of students. Once a class is defined, I can define properties of a class. It is like defining student info, struct student info. So these are the properties. Student has roll number, student has hostel number, student has marks, student has CPI, whatever. But there is also a behavior. Student CPI will be calculated like this. Student's hostel number will change from this to this in this fashion. So these properties are also part of that class. Today, we are able to put the properties in an isolated fashion for students, for employees. But we are not able to put the behavior and tag it with these properties. In an object-oriented paradigm, I can take my programming constructs to a level where I can say that these are the properties of these objects of a class, and this is exactly how the behavior of every object will be. That student CPI will be calculated in this fashion only. And to the external world, I will not permit to define CPI in any which way. So I can define what interfaces external world has with any object. And I will say you are permitted to interact with the object of this class only using this interface and nothing else. Please remember, today in your C++ program, it is not possible. Because in your program, you can arbitrarily take fifth element of an array and set it to anything that you want, no matter what that fifth element defines. Such a independence and freedom is detrimental to proper systematic programming. So you try to utilize the object-oriented concepts and try to define what we call an object-oriented programming. The cornerstone of the object-oriented programming is the ability to define classes, to define properties and behavior for every class, to ensure that all elements of that class inherit the same properties and same behavior. These properties usually will describe data elements, and the behavior is defined through member functions. What is guaranteed is, other than these member functions, nothing else in the world can ever change any value of the data element of that object. That is the guarantee. So you don't have the liberty of going and changing any element of array, changing any value of variable as you please. It is not possible. These member functions are also called methods. Let us see some examples very quickly. We'll of course be elaborating on this in the rest of the course. So these member functions are brought to operate whenever a member is instantiated. It is like defining a variable. You are given struct info, struct student info, something, something. Later on in int main, you say struct student info S. Now S is one student. In our terminology, S is one object. The moment you create S, not only memory is allocated to various data elements, but S now becomes ready to work with all the functions which have been defined for that class. It is not just the data element, but also the function. So behavior also gets defined. When you define a class, you define also the member functions. Sending parameters to a function is like passing a message across the membranes of the cell. Only that is the only mechanism to do anything with those member function, member data element. And you can do so only using public function. That is why when you define a class, you can define private functions and public functions. There is a third category called protected functions or protected access. We'll not go into that. Most importantly, all private data members of an object are hidden from us. We do not know what is the name of a variable which contains CPI of a student. We do not know that. We cannot change it. We can only call a function saying, please calculate, recalculate CPI. Okay. And I can send some parameters, grades in various courses, whatever, whatever. What it does internally, its own problem. So let us quickly see some preliminary example. You say class, class name. It's very much like struct, some name. Okay. The only difference is in a struct, you will define only data elements and a structure. Here you define data elements and functions, which are all private. Then you say public colon, and you define public member functions. These public member functions are the ones which rest of your program can use to do anything with the object. Then there is a class called protected. Protected access, will not go into the details of this. I have included only for the sake of completeness. Once you define this class at the beginning of your program or before your program, you can then instantiate an object by writing class name C1. It will create, just like a variable C1 is created by saying int C1, class name C1 will create an object C1. CList 1000 will create an array of 1000 objects, each one of which is an object. How do I use member functions? How do I initialize values, etc., etc.? Here is an example. Employee class. I am defining class of employee, class employee, char EMP name, float EMP salary. Just two parameters. Each employee has salary, each employee has a name. I defined public functions. Please note, I am not defining the complete function. I am defining only the prototype. In a class definition, a prototype is sufficient at the beginning. I have to, of course, define these functions in details, which I can do immediately following the class definition. Notice the four names. Set name, get name. Set salary, get salary. And there are parameters. Set name, there is a character string. Get name, there is a character string, which is an array. When I send an array character string pointer, I will get back the name in that itself. In set salary, I send a floating point value, which is to be set to salary. In get salary, there is no parameter. It returns a floating point value. These are the four functions with which I can operate upon this object. Please note that I have EMP name and EMP salary. These are not visible to me. In my program, there is no way I can assign a value to EMP salary of any person. This is very much unlike that struct EMP info. Struct EMP info, if I had said that, and then later on said struct EMP info, say E1, then E1.EMP salary equal to something I could write. That is not feasible here. Anything that you want to do with values inside the object has to be done through the public functions. Here are the definition of two or three, four public functions here. Void employee colon colon, this is called a qualifier, because employee is the name of the class. Set name, char star nm. Or what I do? Simple, string copy, emp name nm. Set salary, what do I do? Whatever is the parameter I get, I assign it to emp salary. Notice that public functions are capable of collecting parameters which come from messages from outside world and access the private members to set their values or get their values. So our interface is to these functions. But when we call these functions, we don't see the internal names. Remember, how will we call this? We'll say set name some array, get name some array, set sal some array. Here is an example of what happens here. Here's the main program. I have said employee E. I have created an object called E. I have defined two E name 60 and float E salary. These are my local variables. They have nothing to do with the actual employee. In these local variables, I read the name and salary of a person. The way I invoke the public function is to say, if this is a object E, I say E dot set name. So object name dot any public function will invoke that public function for that object. Please remember, when employee E is defined, the space is created in the memory for that employee. The data elements are put there. And also the prototype definitions are logically available along with that employee. Every object inherits all properties, not just the data elements, but also the behavioral property. So when I say E dot set name and I pass E name, it will set that name. E dot set salary, E salary. It will take the E salary, execute that public function. We know what it does. Later on in my program, if I say E dot get name and give some E name, it will get the value of the name of the employee. Similarly, it will get the value of the salary of the employee. I can print it. Logically, what has happened? We're doing similar programming, but we have isolated things now very well. Object class is now an independent thing. I have defined the functions appropriately. Utilizing these functions is very easy. I say E dot something, and that something happens. Here is the issue. The modern programming languages which have these object-oriented features such as C++ and Java, which are most popular, C# is a similar object-oriented programming language in the Microsoft environment. There are some scripting languages such as Python. Object-oriented programming is not new. In the 60s, people have thought of object-oriented programming without naming it like that when they were working on artificial intelligence problems and had defined a programming language called Lisp. Subsequently, there were languages called Modula. There was a number of other programming languages. But today, object-oriented programming has become the mainstay of professional programming in most cases. I will just take 5 more minutes to tell you about an interesting class library. So far, we talked about function libraries. In C++, actually, you have class libraries apart from these function libraries. And these class libraries come with predefined classes and with predefined public functions for those classes, all implemented. So when you compile your program using these class libraries and include these class libraries, you can invoke any of those functions to get variety of things done. What we are very quickly looking at it, and we will elaborate this in the next class, is the graphic object displaying capability. We typically want several windows on our screen. This is one window what you see. We want to draw graphical shapes such as rectangles, circles. We want to plot graphs. We want to show bitmap images, okay, like the ones which we saw earlier. And we want to write text strings in Windows. These are the various things I want to do. I don't even know how to draw graphics by any program now. But suppose I use a graphics package. The one which we shall be using is called EZ Windows. It contains several classes here. For example, this is one basic thing called Windows class. So if you use a Windows class, it is possible for you to define a window on the screen. What you see in the white is a window. It has two parts, a title at the top. Now if I want to create a window, I don't write any graphic program. I have to call a member function. What will I have to send as a message to that member function? Various parameters. Which are the parameters? First of all, where this window should be located. So I will need to say, what is this displacement? And what is this displacement? Please note that the origin is always leftmost corner of an object. And the XY coordinates work in a funny fashion. Y increases downwards. That is the method that EZ window uses. So I will have to specify these two things. Let us say I call this some Y0 and X0. Then I'll have to give the coordinates, say height and width of the window. And I may have to say what I want to be written here. Say I want to call it my window. So 5 parameters. Which are those 5 parameters? X0, Y0, the position of this corner, the window size, H and W, and what string I want to give. I would like a facility by which say, I have defined my window as say MW. And I would like to say MW open. And I will give these parameter values. I would like somebody to immediately draw this window for me. In exactly the same fashion, I could actually draw variety of other features. For example, I may say draw a triangle. I may say draw a triangle which is all red. I may say draw a line. Okay. I may want to say draw a sine wave. How can a graph of sine x be drawn? I have to draw various points actually, right? It so happens that EZ windows does not have a function to draw a point. It can't draw a point. It can draw a line, it can draw a rectangle, it can draw a circle. So one simple way of forcing it to draw a point is to draw a line from a point to itself. You're cheating the system. Actually, if you do that, that point is not even visible. But if you draw a point from that to some 0.005 centimeter or something, you'll actually get a point. We shall see all such things in the subsequent class in greater details. Okay, thank you so much.